Nobody wants to get united.
Like, what we gotta do is meet everybody at 149th Street at the bench.
How many of you guys have wanted to shade your graffiti and you had no idea where to start? You see, I'm gonna be teaching you guys how to shade your graffiti. But even more than that, I'm gonna be teaching you how light works. That way you can shade pretty much anything. But before we get into it, I do gotta let you guys know, I just released the How to Shade ebook. So if you want a deeper dive into this topic, if you want more information and you want to learn more shading styles for your graffiti and your art in general, then be sure to check out that book in the description down below and pick one up. So without further ado, let's get right into it. Let's begin this tutorial really nice and simple, something really basic that we can all kind of wrap our heads around, just to teach the general formula and the concept that we're trying to learn here. So here we have our basic shape, and we have our light source. And our light source is beaming down rays of light onto our form here. And what this does is it gives us our form separated into two halves. You have one area encased in light, and then the other area encased in shadow. Pretty simple enough, nothing too crazy. Now the area where the light family and the shadow family meet is called the terminator. And you can see the terminator marked in red. Now the terminator is interesting, because oftentimes when we see it, it looks like it might be blended. It looks like a smooth gradation. But sometimes in real life with our own eyes, and especially with a digital program, if you look really closely, you'll always be able to find a definitive point where the light and the shadows actually meet. A little bit of a secret here, this is actually why like master level artists, they draw really defined terminators. When I was doing figure drawing, that was a big thing, is understanding where your terminators lie. Because this is what defines the form. Your terminator is the most important part of defining a form with lights and shadows. But the terminator has a little layer of complexity on top of that, because it has this little friend here called your halftones. And your halftones are marked here in purple. And this is where the lights and the darks actually begin to blend into one another. Now here in this example, our halftones are excessively thin, but you'll be able to see what halftones actually look like a little later. We're just trying to keep this as simple as possible just to convey the general concepts. Now the question becomes, why is our terminator here rather than like up here or down here? I'm glad you asked. There's a really simple answer to that. And that's because this point marked in green is where our actual light source meets the apex of the circle. And when I say apex, I do mean relative to the actual light source. And you'll notice that the actual terminator connects these two points. And that's always true. The terminator always connects the two points between where the light actually hits. And what's dope is we can actually use this information in order to find out where our cast shadow is. Now we're not talking about drop shadows here. Drop shadow and cast shadow are two totally different topics. So if we follow this light further down, what we'll find is it actually shows us where our cast shadow is. But you see, shadows aren't just pitch black. I mean, if I just go ahead and block my face out, this right here is in shadow. But did it suddenly become invisible? Is it suddenly pitch black? The answer is, well, no. That means that light is still getting in here somehow, and as a result, light is bouncing off the surface of my face and reflecting back at you, which allows you to actually see this. And this is where we get the topic of reflective lights. Reflective lights are when little tiny photons from your actual light source pass by the form itself, hit the surface the form is nearby or standing on top of, and it reflects off of that surface and back onto the actual form itself. And that creates a little bit of an illuminated area right here in the shadow area. Now we do gotta make something perfectly clear. And it's something newer artists of all kinds kind of mess up a little bit. So I do wanna warn you about this. Nothing in your shadow family can ever be as light as anything in your light family. This includes the reflective light. Your reflective light cannot be as light as anything in the light family. And the reason for this is because by the time the photons actually shoot down, hit the floor, and bounce back up, they're in a weakened state. They're not as strong as they used to be. And as a result, they're not going to be able to illuminate as much as when they initially hit the form. Up until this point, we've been looking at all of these examples on a flat circle, which causes our terminator to be pretty straight. You see, your lights and your shadows actually have to travel across the surface of whatever they're being applied to. So when you look at an actual sphere, the terminator is going to be more rounded, it's going to be more arc, and it's going to bend across the surface of the sphere. This is just as true for other forms like cylinders, cones, pyramids, and cubes. All texture and shadows and all that good stuff is going to have to actually conform to the surface of that form. Now there is a little something I didn't introduce you guys to, and that's something called a core shadow. A core shadow essentially is just the darkest part of your shadow. Now when we check out these more realistic forms, you'll notice that all the formulas I taught you earlier in the video still apply 100% to these as well. The light source still emits light, it hits the apex relative to the light source, we can draw our terminator connecting both of those apexes. This is true for every single terminator. But what I find really interesting is if we check out the actual light area versus the dark area, we'll notice that the values in the light area never really transition all that quickly, not until they get closer to the actual terminator itself. That's when they start to transition more rapidly. If you transition into darks way too quickly on your form, then you're gonna flatten your image and it's gonna look weird. We don't want that, right? So you you want to go ahead and hold your light values for just a little bit and then transition once again more rapidly as you get closer to the terminator. That's important for conveying forms. Now keep in mind, these reflective lights are a lot more exaggerated than what you would typically see in real life, and I want to make sure that you guys are actually able to see these things, and I want to make sure that you can actually see the transitions between each value as well. That's why we have a really defined core shadow, a really defined midtone, and really defined reflective lights. So how does all this relate to something that you might shade in graffiti? Well, you might have seen throw-ups much like this one from my homie Mask, where you have a definitive highlight that goes around your image. This type of shading is really popular, not only for throw-ups, but it's also popular for pieces as well. And it's something that you could even see in my friend Mucky's piece as well. This method of highlighting is extremely common in graffiti, and it follows the same formula that I just taught you. Albeit, the formula I taught you is a little bit more in-depth, but it works all the same. So let's actually apply it to some graffiti. Here we have our little bit of a straight letter, and you can do this at home, you can follow along with your own, and you'll notice that we have our light source on the top left. And as a result, what happens? Our highlights respond to that accordingly, being at the top or on the left-hand side of any box that they're a part of. So you always want to double-check your highlights and make sure that they're all on the proper side, because if they're not, like this one right here, or these other ones, then your lights are going to be on the wrong side, and it's going to flatten your image, because you have no light source over here in order to create those highlights. And you can't even say that they're reflective lights because of the rule we talked about before. Because remember, nothing in the shadow side can be as light as anything in the light side, and all three of these would be in the shadow side. But yet they're the same intensity as the actual lights in the light side. So as a result, they would just flat out be wrong. Assuming you got all your highlights correct, you also want to double check your drop shadow. Because oftentimes I see newer graffiti artists, and even experienced graffiti artists, put their drop shadow in the wrong direction. And since our light source is on the top left, our light source would be illuminating all of this area, which means that this would not have shadow as it would be encased in light. And the same is true for all of the other areas with drop shadow in it. Now, provided that you got both of those things right, let's say you go ahead and you're doing your straight letter and you map out every single light and you put it exactly where it's supposed to be. But when you look back, it looks a little clustered. It looks a little bit crowded and you don't really like it, but you don't know why. The issue might end up being that you have too many lights, and as a result, you've also flattened your image. That's the same thing as if I were to go ahead and take this light right here. This is horrible to look at. You don't want to see that. And that's the equivalent of putting too much highlights on your work. As we can see here, we have a highlight here as well as there. And because of those, my piece looks a little bit clustered to me and I don't really like it. So I can opt in order to go ahead and get rid of those highlights in order to free up the image a little bit. But you can't get rid of just any highlights. You can't just look at any highlight you want and go, you know what? God. Because if you get rid of the wrong highlight like we did here, then suddenly something looks like it's missing. And the reason this is wrong, the reason this looks off is because, well, if this is getting a highlight and this is getting a highlight, that means that the light source is intense enough to reach all that distance. So there's no way you wouldn't have a light here, as it is closer to the light source. Now that's just only the tip of the iceberg as far as highlighting and shading is concerned. That's as simple as it gets, and that's the majority of what graffiti artists use to shade. But we can take this a lot further. We can shade pieces much more realistically. This is something that I've been doing, as well as many other graffiti artists have been doing for absolute years. And as you can see from my friend Theron here, and this honestly isn't all that difficult. If you've been able to keep up with the lesson this far, you're gonna be able to do this with no problem. So you can start off with your piece. And as you can see, we have one value for the entire 3D. Nothing special. From here, we can go ahead and apply our lights and our darks according to our light source. As you'll notice, this little pit in here is a little bit darker, and then this one, as the form rounds outwards, it kind of brightens up until it gets to a highlight. And then as it kind of turns away from our light source again, it gets darker as well. Now, lights in graffiti tend to be uniform. They don't really vary as much as lights in realism. For example, things closer to my light source are gonna receive more light than things further away from my light source. Things further away aren't gonna get as much light because, well, the light dissipates over time. In graffiti, that's not the case. Lighting tends to be very uniform in graffiti, so do keep that in mind. If you wanna apply more realistic lighting that dissipates over time, then that's fine as well. What we did add, though, is a little tiny cast shadow in certain areas, like you'll see right there. And we even have it on the leg of the U, as it's being cast from this opposing leg on the opposite side. This is something we go in great detail about in my actual ebook, but these cast shadows are essentially going to be when light hits a surface, like right here, and then it casts this shadow down onto the next form. So once again, light hits this, and it casts this entire shadow onto this form. And the same is true for here as well. But we also include a little something called occlusion shadows. And these are really fun, because you don't really have to do much for these. An occlusion shadow essentially is when an object stops light from reaching another area. So as you can see, the part where the phone actually touches my hand is extremely dark. The occlusion shadow is the darkest part of a cast shadow. And we can do that in our graffiti as well. We have a little bit going throughout the piece, and it's a great way to go ahead and build up depth in an image really, really easily as well. You're gonna repeat this process throughout the entire image, and you can make this as easy or as difficult as you feel comfortable with. As you can see, we have a lot more shadows in this version of the image But we can choose to go simpler, and it's also perfectly fine. And once you have that down pat, you're gonna go ahead and blend all of it. And it's gonna leave you with a little something like that. Now, for shading your graffiti, if you wanna add a little bit of extra pop, something in order to make the piece explode off the surface, add a little bit of reflective light in places where it makes sense, in order to develop some contrast in your shadow areas. This is also a great way to introduce color into certain areas as well, as the reflected light is going to have whatever color properties the light is reflecting from. And that's pretty much it, guys. That's pretty much a wrap. It's that easy. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comments down below. I'm here to help. And don't forget, the ebook that we just released contains a bunch more in-depth information for those of you guys who want to really dive deep into this topic. So if you want shading to be easy, if you want to become a master of shading your graffiti really quickly, then go down in the description and pick yourself up a book. But with all that said, guys, I hope today's video helped you out. I hope it went ahead and taught you a little bit about this topic, and soon you'll be shading like a pro in no time. And if you enjoyed today's video, be sure to give it a like. It helps out a bunch. If you're new here, subscribe. Become part of the smartest graffiti community anywhere online. And if you want some more graffiti tutorials, we got a series of playlists right here that teach you everything you're going to want to know about graffiti. And down here we have even more graffiti content. But with all that said, guys, I want to thank you for watching. I'll catch you guys next week, but until then, peace.